नमस्कार आईच्या या खाशेल्या हेडोनात तुमकां सगळ्यांक येवकार. आमच्या बरोबर अशी गेस्ट आसात, म्हाका दिसता काँग्रेसीच्या राजकारणाच्या केंद्रस्थानी फाटली 72 आवर्स ते आसात आनी तांणी हांगा येवन जे कितें घडपाचें ते म्हाका दिसता बऱ्याच प्रमाणांत आडोवनय धरला. ते काँग्रेसीचे ज्येश्ठ फुडारी आनी काँग्रेसीचे डेस्क इन्चार्ज दिनेश गुंडूराव इज विथ अस इन द स्टुडिओ. सर वेलकम.
Let me start with a very, very interesting question from my perspective as a journalist. That the press conference that we addressed on the night of 10th was an unprecedented one. A desk in charge holds that press conference and says that these are the people who are trying to betray us. I haven't heard a press conference like that before. What prompted you to do that?
Our own MLAs told us what all was happening, who was speaking what, how they are trying to be influenced, coerced, from one side, from within, and one from without. That is our own people and from the BJP side. Both sides in combination were working to create a 2/3 split of the Congress party. So, and we, when our tallest leaders, whom we respect and have so much regard for, and who have been, you know, given so many positions in the Congress party and are still holding important positions, they themselves start, you know, it is very disappointing. And these are all young, first, most of our MLAs are first time MLAs, yeah, and young fellows. So instead of setting an example and guiding them, you know, to be a good MLA, a good legislator, to be an effective opposition, instead of doing that, if these people, for their personal benefits, if they misguide these people and, you know, take them on the wrong path, I think there was, and it was a very critical time when they did the press conference. So we had to tell the people what is happening. Otherwise, people will not know what is happening.
No, this issue of betrayal, because you have been holding meetings 24 hours before that press conference.
Yeah.
You are meeting all of them.
Yeah.
What indication did they give you?
See, this effort to engineer a split was being attempted by our own people. Though we did that CLP meeting that day, when 10 MLAs came, except for Mr. Digambar Kamath, even that day, after the meeting, many people told what all is happening. Yes, they came, but some of them were planning this. And definitely it was being planned. And it is very evident. People may say, we went to CM's house. What is wrong in going to CM's house? When you know all this is happening, and if you go to CM's house, what does it mean? If the speaker's office is kept open, what does that mean? If people from chief ministers from Assam are calling some of our MLAs and talking to them, what does that mean? If leaders of BJP are talking to our MLAs, what does that mean? So, and if so, it was very clear what was happening, that BJP wanted this to happen. Some people from Congress, for their personal benefits, whatever it may be, you have to ask them only, they wanted this to happen. So, I think that was the story that is has been played out in front of, anybody may deny, Mr. Pramod Samant may deny, my CT Ravi is saying 12, he doesn't even know the number, we have 11 MLAs, he is saying 12 MLAs are going to come to call BJP, he is saying. So it is very evident that this is was being planned. The reason, you may ask me why?
Yeah,
why?
Obviously.
The reason is, one thing is, see, for the BJP, it is very clear that they want to have an authoritarian rule in this country, not only Goa, across the country. They are capturing institutions, they are capturing the media, they are capturing the industrialists, they are capturing the Indian resources with their hands now. They are using that immense money power and political power and institutional power to see that this becomes a one party rule and they can do what they want. So, that is a larger picture.
That's a larger picture. Yeah. But when it comes to this particular instance, one thing that is increasingly becoming clear now is that this whole thing was engineered by your own MLAs and then backed by BJP, rather than BJP engineering it and then your MLAs falling for it.
See, this is,
don't
now,
you think that's a very troubling thing?
No, this is now a chicken and egg. Where it started from, I do not know. But I would accept, and I have told openly, that the conspirators are from within. And it was from the people whom we hold in the highest regard and whom Congress party has given the highest positions. They are the people who are doing this. So now there is no doubt that this was being done from both sides. You need two palms for a clap, no? It can't just be the one person saying, I want to go, another person saying, if they didn't want, they would have told them, no, we can't, why do we need you? I've got 25 MLAs, why do I need Congress MLAs? But for BJP, I think they must be saying, okay, let's split the Congress. If 8, 9, 10, they were saying even 10 are coming, 9 are coming, all comes, then what is the opposition in the state then? If 34, 35 are on one side, what will 2, 3, 4 MLAs do? So, that is a, you know, that's the reality.
I interviewed Digambar Kamath yesterday and I asked him his reaction about your press conference. And he said that he is stunned and deeply hurt. How do you respond to that?
See, like you said, my press conference was unprecedented.
Yeah, right? Absolutely.
So, for that to happen, you can imagine what must have happened. So, I think Mr. Digambar Kamath himself was a person who took the oath in front of the temple, church, everywhere. He was the one who read out the oath with other people followed. If he answers his own conscience, I think that is more than enough. If you are a God-fearing man, truly if you are a God-fearing man, truly if you are all that, if you answer your own conscience, that is good enough. I don't need to spell out because it doesn't look good for me also to talk about him. It pains me also to talk about him. Because we worked so closely. The entire election strategy was his. If he had come to power, he was the chief minister. And we did everything together.
But he feels that party has done a lot of injustice towards him.
I do not know from what angle he is saying.
He says he was not declared as the chief ministerial candidate. He says then after the election, the leader of opposition's post went to a MLA who was just 3 months old in the party.
For a person who has been...
He was not consulted before taking that decision.
See, certain things are decided by High Command. After the loss in 5 states, in every state, CLP leader was changed, PCC president was changed. And in fact, I also spoke to him and said, would you consider to become even the PCC president? I don't know about what is going to happen about leader of opposition because Delhi sending an observer, they are taking a report and they'll, but are you, if you are interested in PCC, why don't you take charge now? So I offered him that. He said, no, I don't want to be PCC president. Even before the election also, I had offered him that, you know, I can talk to High Command if you are interested. Why don't you become PCC president and take over the whole party and run the party for the election? So he said, I prefer to be leader of opposition. So these are all internal things. So there's no humiliation. He was the only person in all the 5 states when people were removed, the only person Mrs. Gandhi accommodated in a bigger position as a member of the Congress Working Committee was Mr. Digambar Kamath. Nobody else in any of the other states, they were removed and no position was given to them, including Girish Chodankar. So Mrs. Gandhi herself said he is a former CM. And if we are bringing in a new younger face, we should recognize him and we should not, treat him with any disrespect. So that is the regard Congress High Command has got for him. So, see, these are excuses, humiliation and all. I do not know, understand where he is hurt, how he is hurt, where is the humiliation. I do not know. I do not understand that.
Second aspect that he is talking about is regarding what is happening now. He says, ki, I have not left the party. I am still with the party and still... party has started taking action against me.
See, like I said earlier, we will not do, why will we want to do take action against him? Why will we want to take action against him or Mr. Michael Lupo? We are not interested. Congress is a large-hearted party. Congress is not a vindictive party. Congress is not a party which is like which wants to take revenge, hold grudges. That is not our culture. We have ruled, we have faced so many difficulties and we are a long history. Congress High Command doesn't work like that. I would expect this maybe from BJP because they can be ruthless. We are not like that. But when situations are going out of control, like I said, if he answers his own conscience, if he goes in front of that same temple, same God and says, I have done nothing wrong, I am very clean, I didn't want anything, I have not spoken to anybody on this. If he is satisfied with his own reply, I will be happy. I don't have any problem. I will not press this matter further. Even today also, we don't want to take any action against him. But even if today attempts are still going to go on, then see, either you put a full stop to it, be clear, or then what option do we have? For me, the party is more important, no?
So
how much ever I may like Mr. Kamath, how much ever I may like XYZ, ultimately for me and for us, we save the party. Already party is suffering.
So, are you saying that in spite of 10 MLAs attending the CLP last night, there are still attempts going on to split the party?
Still attempts are being made by BJP. still the offers of monies have increased, offers of position has increased. We will, now everybody is being offered, I don't know how many ministers BJP can make. Each, many of the MLAs are being called, okay, we'll make you a minister now, come, we'll give you money. Even today, it's today morning also it has happened. So what do I say to this?
And MLAs were solicited today morning also.
Today morning also. They called me back and said, we are being called, we are now, the offers are going up. And I believe there is a division in the BJP in the state. The chief minister is desperate to see that this goes through. The CM, maybe within their own factions, there are there within BJP. One faction, state BJP, does not want this to happen. They don't want Mr. Michael Lobo in. They don't want Mr. Kamathin. But one faction, that is the CM's faction, is desperately trying all its efforts to see that this goes through. There's their own internal politics. So these efforts are going on. But what I'm very confident about is, there are some MLAs who have stood solidly, stood strongly, and are not yielding to this pressure. That I think is, I must appreciate our MLAs who have stood by us.
What happened with Michael Lobo? He's the leader of opposition. Do you think the pressure that was exerted on him by the government resulted in he making such kind of moves? What is his explanation?
You should ask him only what his explanation is for what
I'm asking. Because he came to the Congress and he said came, that he has given a detailed explanation.
He came and he spoke. See, things are very, now we were talking with all the cards open now. There's nothing to hide.
Yeah.
So we spoke to him with the open cards only, that this is a situation. So unless this situation stops and the trust is rebuilt, then we can work things through, because we are not going to say we are going to shut the door on anybody. We can still work things through, but we can't have the situation where, there's a saying in English, you can't run with the hare and hunt with the hound. You can't be running also with the hares, and at the same time you can't be hunting us also. You want to hunt, you want to kill me. Or you want to go with me and run with me.
You decide.
Yeah. You can't be trying to do both. Because then you're betraying not only yourself, you're betraying the party, you're betraying the trust, you're betraying the positions that we've given you. And you're betraying the mandate of the people also, ultimately. You're betraying the oath you gave to the gods also. So don't do that. You want to take a clear decision.
I'm tempted to.
Nobody can stop anybody, no. Somebody wants to go, ultimately. If he's ready, for whatever reasons, could be personal, could be political, could be his ideological, could be some principles, whatever it could be, you take a decision.
Do you think, sir, today that Michael Lobo is politically targeted, or right now you would want to reserve your comments?
I agree. Even when after he came, he took also a risk by leaving BJP and coming. I appreciate it. He took a stand, he joined the Congress, he contested on a symbol. BJP is known to be a very vindictive party. BJP is known to that they have all the agencies in their control. And we gave him, after he joined us, he won. And we also recognized his, and we made him the CLP leader. For a person who has just joined the party, for us to make him a CLP leader is not a joke. Party is also, it's discussed at the highest level. But we said, okay, fine, he has come, he's young, he wants to think, and he's taken a risk also. And he was targeted by BJP, no doubt. Everybody knows there are cases going on against him. They are targeting him. And I told him many times, you don't worry. You face it. We are with you fully. We will back you fully. I'm not asking you to step down. I won't ask you to remove anything. You are there. We are there with you. You take this on and we will stand by you. Party will stand by you. You don't have to think twice whether the party will be with you or not on this issue. So we gave him that strength. And politics, you have to fight, no?
Yeah.
Once you take certain decisions, you have to face it. That's when you become a leader. That when people will say, yes, he's taken the stand and he's fighting it out.
Michael Lobo now claims that he himself suggested that he wants to step down.
Yeah, he suggested to me that if you feel like I am willing to step down. So he told me a couple of times. I said, you don't worry about that. We have made you be strong. You are now the leader. Don't succumb. Don't feel threatened or scared. You face and we are with you. So if you succumb, then neither will you, earn good name. And they will, whether what they will do to you, I don't know. So you face it, and we are with you. So whatever strength that I could give, we could give, we have given him.
So you moved very quickly to file disqualification petition against both of them, Digambar Kamath and Michael Lobo. What's the strategy here? Because if you are saying that you are not shut doors on anybody, and at the same time you have filed disqualification petition, that very much looks like not just shutting the door but slamming the door on their face.
See, the petition was filed because when you try to split the party and when you are involved in those activities, then, and we have got evidence that they have done that, speaking to our MLAs, talking to our MLAs, sending people, their relatives going and talking, they themselves going to their houses and sitting and saying, let's go, we will get this, we will get that, what is Congress? No, all those things have been spoken by. So, if we don't take action, then what is the party all about then? So, it is like, what is disqualification? When you, it's like these actions are like voluntarily giving up your membership. So we have filed a petition in front of the speaker. Let's see what the speaker does. Then we will see as per law what happens.
The biggest question before you is about the choice of leader of opposition. Assembly is in session. Everybody is waiting to know who the leader of opposition is. Where have the things gone now?
See, right now I would not want to comment on this because this is a situation where still things are a little bit muddy. So we need things to clear out a little bit before we decide on what to do next. So we can't have this again repeating. Otherwise, Congress will become a joke. CLP leader himself wants to leave. Means what does it mean? So we can't have these things repeating. So we have to be careful. So we will just allow things to settle down a little bit. And then we will take a decision.
So why do you think this is repetitively happening? Because one part is okay. BJP is trying to engineer defection. Second part is, why are your MLAs falling for it again and again?
See, now it's not only Congress, no. You saw what happened in Maharashtra. You're seeing in other states, even other parties are being targeted. But principally, I would say one thing is that there is a huge accumulation of money and the political power on one side. So people can be threatened. You see how we all know how ED and IT are operating. You see in any state, whenever there's a political crisis, ED enters, suddenly starts raiding Congress party or opposition party, MLAs, their leaders, their relatives. Suddenly it becomes active. It is so, everything is coordinated. That means what? These institutions, IT, ED, all the CBI, all are working in control of the BJP, not the government, not the department. So, and it's very easy today to harass people. There are so many journalists who have been put behind bars. Why? Because they have raised certain issues. Some comment made 4 years back, the person goes to jail. He can't get bail. Someone who's made a comment now and it's international news, that person is running free. Why? So, see, there is fear. There is intimidation. There is money. There is, inducements. So this systematic effort, like I said earlier, to create a one nation, one religion, one country, one leader, one philosophy.
Don't you think Congress also needs to introspect, because you're losing governments after governments. You're losing MLAs after MLAs, and they're feeling that they don't have a very secured future in the party.
I don't deny the fact that we have to also definitely, pull our socks up. We have to fight back. We have to show that we are there. We are willing to, put, like in Goa, we fought the election hard. We didn't, not that we didn't fight the election hard. People thought Congress is coming to power. Many people, even BJP also felt that Congress has got a chance. Ultimately, okay, fine. Certain things went wrong, division of votes, other reasons, all those things are there. But it's not that we didn't fight hard.
Yeah.
But yes, there is a situation in the country today where people are also being, I would not say the thing, but there is a perception of this communalization that is happening. This Hindutva that is being, hate agenda that is being propagated, where people are being, influenced by that. See, they're getting influenced by the religious card. So these are all playing out. And politics is ultimately, whatever is happening in society is politics. And when a society gets communalized, it is getting communalized. Today you see hate speeches, today you see violence, today you see so much of division happening. Hindu versus Muslim, Hindu versus Christian. and all these things. So the country is also getting split in all these various ways. So we are fighting against that also. So it is a tough battle for us, but we will fight, and we need to improve ourselves. I agree with you.
So last two questions. Number one, do you think because you mentioned division of votes, when you look at the assembly results, do you solely blame it on division of votes, or do you think there are other factors at play that significantly restricted your tally? It certainly increased from 1 to 11, but the factors that restricted your tally.
Yeah, see, now I don't analyze that results now, because it's a long process. There are so many factors. Of course, division of vote was a big factor. You had entry of Trinamool Congress, and then AAP is already there, and RG came from, you know, nobody expected them to get so much of votes. Then other issues also cropped up, and plus, I think in certain constituencies, organizationally, we are weak, certain pockets. So there's so many factors, and we had lost all of our powerful candidates. All of them had got defected to BJP. All are tough, strong, powerful, those we considered who can manage elections. They had left us. So we were left with newcomers, fresh people, young people. So, you know, all those factors.
I asked you that question only because of one reason. Because one policy of yours, which everybody applauded, and I believe that nobody can dispute about it even after the results, is that you said that you will not give ticket to defectors. Were you disappointed after seeing the results that you took a tough stand, you decided that you are going to pursue a certain, probably ethical path, and it did not give you desired results?
See, to some extent it gave a result, because many of those defectors lost. So whether we didn't gain too much,
they lost.
Many of them lost. Then some of them didn't get tickets also, and then see, now in ultimately we did what we thought was right and what people of Goa will appreciate. So I think we, like you said, we did get appreciation. In fact, for us to become 11, maybe that also helped. Maybe the people who won, at least Congress did the right things. Like we had Mr. Reginaldo, who wanted to come back to Congress. We didn't take him back, even though we knew that he is a good candidate. But he said, if we take him back, then what is the impression of the party then? So it's like even today now, if we had not moved on these people, then what is the impression of the party? People can do anything they want and still, like, you know, get away with it. So we can't allow that to happen, no.
Now when we are talking about this post-poll defections, and which you are trying to avert, you are still saying you are trying to avert, and there are still attempts that are going on to go ahead with that split. Do you think, and I'm very tempted to ask you this, your biggest strength right now is that video of oath taking, rather than those affidavits that they have signed? The biggest thing in your arsenal right now is that video of oath taking in temples, churches and dargah.
See, there are two things to this. One is, okay, nothing has happened till now, but moves were made.
Yes.
So the people who took oath, is definitely that moral issue is there now. It's there. But the other problem now is nobody is going to believe it anymore. If things go, it would have almost gone wrong. Yeah. Luckily, you know, we managed, some people, ethical people, principled people, stood the ground, didn't happen. So people will lose faith in this also. Next time if someone goes and says, I'm going to take an oath in front of God, they'll say, we've seen enough of this, nobody is going to even respect it or value it. This taking oath in front of God will lose its effect. Nobody will believe it. So now the people who have taken oath are supposed to be the biggest believers of God, or so they claim. So I think if they themselves are willing to betray the God, then who else will you?
What about the humans, you are saying?
What about the rest of the ordinary humans who are not so much believers in God? The oath taker, only if he is ready to do it, then what about the people who are following the oath taker?
So final question, one message to Michael Lobo, one message to Digambar Kamath right now.
I'm saying again that we are a large hearted party, but we can't do both. You can't do both. We always want our people to be with us. We love and respect them. We love and respect them. But you can't do both. You can't sit with us, and you can't also stab us in the back.
Or do you feel that Michael Lobo is at a point of return, but Digambar Kamath is at a point of no return?
I don't see anything. In politics, nothing is impossible. Politics is always, there is so many things have happened in politics. We want all to work together, work as a good opposition party. There's so much of pride in being a good opposition. I was telling our MLAs, to become a leader, you have to be in opposition. If you're in ruling, you're just in the queue. Whatever CM does, whatever high command says, here as an opposition party, you get so much of respect. You use that position. We can be a good opposition party. 11 MLAs, if you work together, you can. Even the government will listen to you. Because hey, this is a strong opposition. You divide yourselves, then not only us, it affects even the other opposition MLAs. Whether it is AAP MLA, whether it is RG MLA, it affects them also.
Yes.
Because when the government is free,
the entire opposition side.
Then the government says, okay, to hell with what is the assembly, what is the thing, we'll do what we want. So that is dangerous for democracy. So I was telling our all people, this is the time for you to become leaders. Use this to talk about the people, fight for people's right. No government can deny you works in your constituency. If they deny you, make a big issue of it. Speak in the assembly. Why this is happening? Make a big, people again will respect you for that.
So right now your message to Michael Oberon, Digambar Kamath is stop hunting with the hound and running with the hare.
That's all.
Dinesh Bab, I know you are on a very busy schedule. You are rushing now to the airport, but still you made time, came here, spoke so frankly as always.
Yeah.
It's a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you. Thank you.